morning, everybody. We're going to get things started. I'll invite you to stand and sing Love So Great. Good morning, Loon Mountain Ministry. One of my favorite things is just getting to see all of you as my family. And I was kind of hoping that song was longer because I was talking to some people back there. Welcome to the coffee shop church service. Welcome to the online church service. This morning we're excited. We're all over the place. The Waterville church service is currently going. Might actually even be over. They get up early. They start their church service at 9 o'clock on top of that mountain. And so Randy and Marissa and Heidi and Abishay and Hattie, Scott and Sharon Bartlett, that crew is down there running the Waterville church service, which is really cool. And here we are. And this is going to be our last coffee shop church service for a while because next week we go to Loon. But we love living on mission together. We love coming together this morning to pool our praise and to pool our resources, to be able to glorify God and to be in his kingdom and to do things that we couldn't do alone. You know, we couldn't do it alone. And so Consistent community and the work of the Holy Spirit. Those two things are really, really key in a Christian life. So this is consistent community. We pray that you've put your faith, hope, and love in Jesus Christ, so that you've been filled with the Holy Spirit, and that's how we move forward in becoming more like Jesus. So if you wouldn't mind, join me in prayer. Lord, we thank you so much for this morning, and we thank you so much for this coffee shop space. We thank you for the people that are gathered, the family here. We thank you for Waterville Valley and the church that's forming down there, and they met on top of Snow's Mountain this morning. Bless that movement. We thank you for the folks that have gathered here, the folks that are online. We think of Nathan and Eunice as they're driving 13 hours with an infant. I ask that you would bless them, Lord, and be real to them. Thank you for their time visiting family. We love you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Song. It's just like, Lord, I want to be in step with you. I don't want to go ahead. I don't want to go behind. You know, in verse 2 it says, Lord, I want to love like you. I want to feel what you feel. I want to see what you see. And in the bridge, I want to see through your eyes. And I think God is delighted with a prayer and a heart that says that. Like, Lord, give me wisdom to know where you are, and I want to be right there. I want to walk with you. So, love that. Next we're going to sing, "'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus." Rejoice because we are known and loved by you. We know you as a father. We know you as a friend. Lord, we trust you. There's no greater peace. There's no greater joy. There's no greater hope. So we claim this truth and we sit and we enjoy. We enjoy sitting in your lap now, Lord, as we worship you, as we're here in fellowship with one another, and with you right here in our midst. We thank you, Jesus, for your love and your sacrifice for us. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
All right, you may be seated. I'm going to do my best Nathan impersonation this morning, the announcements. If you turn on the back of your bulletins, I'm going to quickly go through these. If you have a baby bottle, they are due on Father's Day next Sunday. But if you have one today, Trish said she'd be willing to grab one for them because Sharon's down at Waterville, so you can give them to Trish. Mountaintop Church services begin tomorrow. Don't panic if you haven't heard back from Loon. None of us have yet. We're working on that. Drew's going to keep working on that. If you haven't heard back from Loon on your pass, we'll keep working on that. But Mountaintop Church services next week. If you end up having to get your pass from the fishbowl, I'd give yourself maybe an extra 20, 30 minutes to get that. I would load the gondola by 10:30, services at 11 at the top. If you'd like to help in any way, be a greeter, set up Tear Down Sound, be a part of the musical, worship band, part of the prayer team, do announcements, read scripture. If being part of the team on the mountaintop is something you'd like to do, we gladly have you, and we'd love to have you. So see one of us, myself or Drew or Nathan, we can chat about it. 8-11 Youth back on at the Jenkins' house this week. Teen group, you're going to have a summer kickoff party on the June 21st barbecue and pool at the Macchio's house if you're a teenager. Women's coffee hour with Sharon in here is Mondays at 10. Dessert first Bible study in here Tuesdays at 7 p.m. No, that's at the Noelle's house.
That's actually at
6. At 6? Wow, okay. All right, so this is how we keep you guys on your toes. Dessert first Bible study this week is at 6, and it's back at the Noelle's house, huh? Ooh, and dessert. It feels good to be back. Dessert first Bible study. And then the Monday night, every other Monday night Bible study, will be back in here June 14th at 6 o'clock with Bill and Scott. If you want to join a missional community group, talk to Trish or Drew. Really cool at their house on Tuesday night. The Summer Waterville Church services, one happening today. The next one's the 4th of July. And you'll see them. If you want to be part of the Waterville movement, you want to see something going on down there, we would gladly have you guys help out down there. We need greeters. If you're lucky enough, Scott Bartlett today was running a chairlift. You could become a lifty. Maybe you've always wanted to become a lifty. So Scott Bartlett's down there running a chairlift. He's got good chairlift jokes going, I'm sure. But if you would like to support us, we could really use your support. You can either shop here Monday through Saturday, coffee shop, thrift shop. You can volunteer here. You can donate items here to the thrift shop. You can donate money. We have a support box there. You can donate online, or if you have a smartphone, you can take a picture of the PayPal and support the movement here and down to Waterville as well. And if you're old school, you can use snail mail too. Tracy. Yes, Jim. Jim, our buddy Jim Jameson, had some complications with his dialysis this last week and has been over at Dartmouth for the last week. I know Drew was able to go visit him yesterday afternoon. Drew said he was in much better spirits. Nancy's been in contact with him all week. I finally got through to him this morning on my walk here. He was really glad to chat. I said it would not be the same without him sitting over there having his coffee. So actually, let's pause real quick. Lord, we thank you for Jim Jameson. And we thank you that we get to be part of his story. Lord, I think about a 90-plus-year-old story. And sometimes I think we can be just such a small part of it. But right now, Lord, we're part of Jim's story, and that's a big part of it. And you've been so gracious to us to allow us to be part of his journey. So today, Lord, I ask by the power of your Holy Spirit, through the nursing care, through the doctor care, through maybe a visit from his brother, it sounds like today, and nephews, Lord, that you would just give Jim a big old hug. He loves hugs, God, and you know that. You made him that way. And that you would just bless him with some hugs today, with people and conversation. We're so thankful that we get to have Jim here at our church here in little town of Lincoln. So we love you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. If you'd like to contact any of us, we'd love to hear from you. Yes, Dave. Oh, that's not on here. Oh, yeah, tell me that. Okay, Sharon. Oh, yes, thank you. On Sunday mornings. You're right. So thanks, Dave. So next Sunday, when we go to the mountaintop We know not everyone's able to go to the mountaintop, and so we want to provide a time for them to be able to connect, study God's word, and just worship together. And so Sharon, right in here at 9 o'clock next Sunday, and that will run throughout the whole summer church services. So 9 o'clock on Sunday mornings, come and hang out. And Sharon said she's even making coffee. And you might get, yeah, she got a coffee lesson from Emily. Nice. And you might get, fortunately, might be some treats left over. Who knows? If you want to contact any of us, please. We'd love to have coffee with you, meet with you, and just chat, get to know your story. I and my family are going to be out at Fast Camp the next 2 weeks. So we're putting together the first ever that we're aware of, Christian ski racing camp out in Oregon. So I greatly appreciate your prayers. The kids and I are driving 46 hours starting tomorrow morning. And I wish Abishay could drive, but she can't yet, and that's all right. And we're going out there to support. This is a collaboration with Snowboarders Skiers for Christ, Loon Mountain Ministry, and Sugarloaf Area Christian Ministry, putting on a faith ski camp. And if you could be praying, that would be great. There's a lot of kids that don't know Jesus that are coming to this camp, which is really, really cool. And what I think is incredible, there's a couple athletes on the U.S. ski team that are believers, and they're like, we want to help. We want to help. This is cool. And so it's called Fast Camp. So we'd love your prayers there, but we'll be back. That's it, I think. Did I miss anything? We're good. Okay. Oh, kiddos.
Yeah.
You can be dismissed. Who are you hanging out with today? Miss Trish. So if you're a kiddo through ages, what are we talking again? 2 to 7?
2 to 7.
2 to 7, you can hang out with Miss Trish over there. Would you like this back?
And I'll invite everyone else to stand and sing Man of Sorrows.
Thank you.
remain standing for our scripture reading today. And Bill Frazier is going to lead us in scripture again. Thanks, Bill.
To see, we get something in the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Old Testament reading will be taken from Ecclesiastes 4:4-6. And the New Testament's from 1 Timothy 6:6-8. Then I observed that most people are motivated to success because they envy their neighbors. This too is meaningless, like chasing the wind. Fools fold their idle hands, leading them to ruin. And yet, better to have one handful with quietness than two handfuls with hard work and chasing after the wind. And 1 Timothy 6:6-8 says, yet true godliness with contentment itself is great wealth. After all, we brought nothing with us when we came into the world. We can't take anything with us when we leave it. So we have enough food and clothing. Let us be content. I had a glimpse at a bumper sticker once that said, he who dies with the most toys wins. But this in a nutshell, godliness with contentment is great gain. God blesses us to be a blessing.
Amen. Thank you very much, Bill. Nathaniel, how am I doing with this? Thanks, brother. That sounds pretty good?
Yeah.
Nice. Good. If I get too loud, just holler at me, all right? Sometimes I get animated. So we've been working our way through the books of wisdom. Who can give me some of the three books of wisdom? Ecclesiastes. Way to go. Nice job right here. That's one. What's the next one? Proverbs and Job. Yep. Ecclesiastes, Proverbs, and Job. We've gone through Job, and now we're four chapters into Ecclesiastes. Remember, if you're having a hard time remembering what these books are about or how they came about or why we are working through them, write down in your notes, thebibleproject.com. Thebibleproject.com, such a good resource, an incredible resource. And just type in the book of Job or type in Ecclesiastes. They have a good resource on every single book of the Bible. And I tell you, for a kid like me who doesn't like long, drawn-out academia classes, I like punchy, quick videos. These are really, really good. They pack a punch in five-minute YouTube videos. Really good. So we're on to the book of Ecclesiastes. Remember, it's kind of written by like our skeptical uncle, who's kind of like blowing smoke on all that we believe. And he's kind of calling us to the carpet and saying, you really do believe that? Really? You think so? I think it's meaningless. And so here we are in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, and today's sermon is really at me. Today's sermon is really at Marcus because, you know, like Bill was saying, contentment is such a beautiful gift from God, and I am not a very content kind of person. I always want more. I always want better, bigger. C.S. Lewis, one of his favorite quotes that I have is from the Chronicles of Narnia in one of the earlier books. Aslan says, further up and further in, further up and further in. And that's something that's beautiful for those of you that struggle with probably anxiety or complacency or fear. You need to hear from C.S. Lewis, further up and further in. Let's go. Those of you that are like me who struggle with never being content and never is enough, I don't maybe necessarily need to hear that. It's like, whoa, Marcus, just take it easy. And Ecclesiastes sheds a light on something, and it talks about motives. Motives are a real big deal in the Bible, and the motives it talks about the birthplace of motives. The Bible says is the heart. Right, and so the Bible says to examine your heart, or the Bible says it will give you a new heart. It'll take your old heart of stone and give you a new heart of flesh. Well, what does that mean? Well, it means that the heart is the birthplace of motives. And the Bible is very clear that you and I were born with not great motives. That our motives are from birth selfish. Our motives are very much about me. And I think about my motives, and the Holy Spirit is redeeming my motives daily. And I don't know about you, but I have to question my motives quite often. And this talks about this. It says, then I observed. Remember, this is like the uncle that's kind of blowing smoke and everything. He says, then I observed. You can hear it kind of in his voice. Then I observed that most people are motivated to succeed because they are envious of their neighbor. I mean, he just sucker punched you, right? Because we want to say that I am motivated out of like, well, I want to succeed and I want to be healthy and like I want to be, you know, I want to be financially secure and I want to be able to provide for my family. Like, how many people say, well, I want to provide for my family. That's what's motivating me. But when you really dig past that, I want to provide for my family, really at the base of wanting to be successful is keeping up with the Joneses, if we're honest. It sounds much better to say, but I want to provide for my children. Really? Your kid needs that and you need this? That's considered provision? When did that happen? You know? And so one of the ways that I want to like show how this has happened in our society is think about the invention of something that altered the course of society forever. Okay? Think about right here in our town. Right? So the interstate came in what year through this town? Does anybody remember? Was it the 70s?
Early 70s,
yeah. So, you know, 93 used to end, where did it end? Was it Concord? Or was it north of Concord? Tilton? It kind of kept going north, though it evolved over time. But in the early 70s, it came through and connected through the Notch, right? Southern New Hampshire and northern New Hampshire through Franconia Notch. What happened to all the mom-and-pop businesses and all the mom-and-pop motels and hotels on Route 3? They died out. Have you ever ridden Route 3? I have, because I like to ride my road bike. I've ridden Route 3 from here to Concord. When you ride Route 3 from here to Concord, you lose track of counting how many old and dilapidated buildings that you can tell used to be hotel, motel, and cabins, right? You know what I'm talking about. So it changed the course of society forever, right? Exit 32 became a thing. Now it's bumper stickers and names of hotels and pizza joints, you know. It became a thing. So it the invention of the interstate or the beginning of the interstate coming through here in the 70s altered some for the good and some not for the great. Where am I going with this? Well, the invention of social media is only about, what would you say, 10 to 15 years old, maybe a little bit older than that. I remember it wasn't when I was in college. Facebook, I'm kind of dating myself now. I graduated college in 2005. I think it had just first began. And I remember, I think, getting my first Facebook account right around maybe 2006 or 2007. And so social media now has been around about 15 to 20 years, and it's changed some things. And psychologists now are willing to talk about, we've got enough data, enough to look at. And one of the things is, the motives of the human heart, according to Scripture, and this is where a lot of people don't like Scripture, this is where they disagree with the truth of Scripture. The Scripture said that the motives of the human heart have been evil since Adam and Eve chose their own way in Genesis chapter 3. That's where a lot of people go, I'm not cool with that. I think that we are born good and then it is our nurturing that makes us bad. I would argue that you've never owned a two-year-old. But anyway, the Bible says that we were born, and it used very harsh language, it says we were born enemies of God. We were born with our own interests at mind. Now the naturalist, the evolutionist would say that's the survival in us, that we were for ourselves because we had to be, because we need to eat, find shelter, find community, and find love. But what drives me kind of crazy sometimes about older generations than me is that you guys will say, the society today is just, it's so bad. Man, it used to be so much better than this. That's not true. Really? The 60s? The 60s? Come on, guys. right? The 60s was all about love, and we can just do whatever we want, right? Now, I would say that now we have a more global look at things than you did in the 60s. Well, shoot, way more of a global look than you had in the 20s, right? And that's what social media has done. Social media has now given us a global opportunity to be envious. Humankind has always been envious. There's not one decade, there's not one generation that's not envious. Now it can be on a global scale, all right? And so it's got some massive ramifications. And we're seeing it right now, really prevalent, and the psychologist has narrowed it down. It's affecting everybody, but it's really affecting the 14-year-old girl. Let me say that again. All psychologists, Christian, non-Christian, psychologists across the board are saying social media is affecting the 14-year-old female in a way that no one ever could predict. Could anyone have predicted that the hotels, motels, and mom and pop corner stores along Route 3 were going to take the hit that they were going to take? Right? No. No one could have predicted 15, 20 years ago that the 14-year-old female was going to take the hit that they were going to take. Let me explain what I have just observed with my daughters and what I've observed among, 14-year-old females in social media. Now, I know that I'm kind of like treading on some pretty thin ice, and I have to be careful here, but I am a father of a 15-year-old and a 13-year-old gal, and so I might not know everything. I would completely admit that. I've never been a 15 or 14-year-old girl, 13-year-old girl, so I don't know. But I have just observed them and their friends. And so I kind of have a front row seat, I guess we'll say. So I'm just an observer. And here's what I've observed, is that social media gives 14-year-old girls a global platform to be affirmed or denied, and a global platform to be envious. We've always been envious. In 1960, you were just envious to the kid sitting next to you in middle school or in high school. You weren't able to be envious of the kid in Austin, Texas. You didn't know. You weren't able to be envious of the kid in Los Angeles, California. You weren't able to be envious of the kid in Japan or China. Now, a 14-year-old girl can be motivated by envy for anyone across the globe of any age bracket or any across the globe. That's 7 billion people. You used to be, if you're from this town, you used to be able to be envious from about, what, 30 people in the 60s? You had a graduating class of 30, 40 maybe, so at the most you could be envious of about maybe 100 people. Now, people have the ability to be envious of 7 billion people because we're connected through social media. And here's what I mean by this. And for a female, I have found it much, the rules of the game are much grander. Let me put it this way. Let's just use Lincoln, New Hampshire as an example. Abishay's graduating class is 16 kids, okay? 16 kids. Now, if one of the high school boys from Linwood post a video on Instagram, or post a video on Snapchat, or post a video or picture on social media, if that is going to get global recognition, that high school boy has to be insanely talented at something, whether it be skiing, or basketball, or music, or really good at video editing and come up with something, and he has to be extremely funny. If that's going to get any attention outside of his peers here and maybe his grandma in a different state, right, it's going to have to be really good if you are a high school boy. Now, let's say you're a high school girl. To get global recognition, all you have to do is wear less and take a picture of yourself that shows parts of your body that get more and more intimate and closer to the core of yourself. And in a moment, just that upload push of a button, you now are global as a 14-year-old female. And a 14-year-old male from Lincoln cannot do that. I've observed it. And the weight and the pressure of that on the 14-year-old female, that the rules for you are global, that's mind-boggling. Mind-boggling. How can you hold that kind of weight? Do you ever find it fascinating that the inventors of Facebook, the inventors of Google, the inventors of Instagram, all these people that are now multi-millionaires will all tell you they do not give phones to their children and they do not let their kids have social media accounts before they're 18. Every single one. I have not heard one that, well, maybe that Jeff guy, but or not, well, who's in charge of Facebook? He still hasn't really come out because he's still going to the bank. But the people that have left the organization have all said, I don't. And it's like, whoa, no, you know. And every household's different. Everyone's making decisions differently. You know, our little glimpse into our household, why, I don't know, but we drew the line at 13. We're like, all right, at 13, we're going to give you a cell phone. At 13, we're going to start trying to work with you to have a social media account. Because at the same time, I don't want to be hypocritical either, because I have them, right? And I've definitely caught myself being addicted to Facebook. I don't even know what I'm doing. I'm just doing this, and I have no idea even what I'm looking at. I don't even read the articles or look and stop the pictures. I've trained my brain to just look at fast-moving pictures and videos, and my thumb goes like this. When I don't know what to do, give me 30 seconds, I have to wait for a phone call. Give me 30 seconds that I have to wait for an order at a restaurant. Give me 30 seconds that I have to wait for a plane. Give me 30 seconds I got to wait in line at a store. What do I do? And I start doing this. I don't even know. It really creeped me out a couple years ago, and so I said, okay, I'm not, my phone is not in my bedroom anymore. So that's just a move that I made. Right? Heidi doesn't have that same problem. For some reason, it didn't make it addicting to her. Right? But for me, I'm addicted to it. And so I said, I don't sleep in, my phone doesn't come in my bedroom anymore. And you know what I did? I went to the thrift shop back when we had electronics, and I got one of those things called an alarm clock that where the numbers are red. Have you ever seen one of those? Crazy, right? And you know what? When the alarm goes off, I can either have it be the radio or right? I go with the radio. You know, and so it's like an alarm clock. Crazy invention, I know. I never had one. I literally got my cell phone my sophomore year in college, and since then, I think it's been my alarm clock. I don't think I've ever had one since then. But envy is a motive of the heart. There's other motives of the heart, but the Book of Wisdom is talking about envy. And envy is the opposite of contentment. So when I looked at contentment and I wanted to say, okay, if we should not be motivated by envy, what should we be motivated by? And contentment's the word. And that's where we got this. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 6 through 8. Yet true godliness with contentment is itself a great wealth. After all, we brought nothing with us when we came into the world, and we can't take anything with us when we leave it. So if we have enough food and clothing, let us be content. It's really hard for me. That's a really, really hard one. Because if I have good food, what do I want? More good food. If I have good times with friends, what do I want? More good times with friends. Poor Randy and Marissa are living with us right now. And if we have a great adult conversation going at 8 o'clock, I want it to go to midnight or 1 a.m. And about 9:45, 10 o'clock, I can see Randy, Marissa, and my wife on our porch going like, and they're content with the adult conversation. Where I'm like, I want more adult conversation than that, come on, you know? And then they go to bed, and then I'm like, well, maybe somebody on here will have an adult conversation. Whoa, what's that, you know? Right? I'm addicted to adult conversation. And we do. And this is why, like I prayed earlier, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, the Bible calls it. So the presence of the Holy Spirit in our life, which comes through confession of our sin with our mouth and believing in God in our heart, the Holy Spirit moves in. And then the consistent community of Christians is needed. Those two things. I've seen many of people who have put their faith, hope, and love in Jesus Christ, but do not have consistent Christian community. They have traded values. They literally have traded values that you're like, how did you get there? Because they don't hang out with Christian community, and so they've justified a way of living. I've also seen people who I would say do not have the presence of the Holy Spirit in their life, but come to church all the time, and you're like, something's missing, all right? You're checking the church box and the Christian community box, but the power of the risen Savior is missing in that life. You know, you're really blind to some things that you wouldn't be blind to if the Holy Spirit was awake and alive and present in your life. And I would, point at myself for both of those. Both of those. I have a tendency to really be drawn to non-Christian community. I love that. That's my gifting. It's my nature. But also, if I just hang out there forever, I begin to trade values. And I also have the tendency to, like, just check the box and be in this traditional, rut and not have the Holy Spirit prevalent and alive in my life. I want to end by this contentment. And when I read a situation like this, it's incredible. There's a verse in Philippians 4:13, and it seems like a lot of pro athletes have it tattooed on their arms, on their necks. They have it on their shoes. And it's that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Right? But I've also seen on a t-shirt from Bible students who are really into the Bible, it says, I can take every verse out of context through Christ who strengthens me. I saw that. That's really good. And if you look at the context of Philippians chapter 4, verse 13, which says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, it goes on to say, I can be content in all things, shipwreck or not, sickness or health, famine or feast, sick or alive, I can be content in all things through Christ who gives me strength. Where a lot of times we like to say, I can succeed in all things through Christ who gives me strength. Now it says, you can be content in all things through Christ who gives you strength. So what the Bible is admitting is that contentment ain't easy. It requires the strength of Christ to be content, right? And when I read a story like I'm going to read you right now, I go, it requires the strength of Christ to be content. This is from a blog written in March. This girl was not as famous as she is right now in March, because a couple days ago, she got the golden buzzer by Simon on America's Got Talent. And her stage name is Night Bride. I don't know if you got to see it, but she got the golden buzzer from Simon. The whole audience was in tears. You'll be in tears when you hear her sing. You'll be in tears when you hear her story. But Night Bride is a gal who has been battling cancer, and she's only 30 years old. And this is from her blog from March 9th, and it says, God is on the bathroom floor, and it is very powerful. And it's very convicting and challenging to me about being content. And I want to read it to you, and I want to close this sermon on contentment with this. And this is what she says. I don't remember much of autumn because I lost my mind late in the summer. And for a long time after that, I wasn't in my body. I was a light bulb buzzing somewhere afar. After the doctor told me that I was dying, and after the man I had married said he didn't love me anymore, I chased a miracle in California. And 16 weeks later, I got it. The cancer was gone. But my brain caught up with it all. Something broke. Oh, you want to just hit ignore? You can say distractions like this are coincidental. I've lived this life long enough that they're not. There is a good team, and there is a bad team. And the good team loves you and wants to save you from yourself and from God's wrath. And the bad team would love to distract you. Absolutely love it. And if you don't believe me, hang out for a while. And those things happen all the time when truth is being communicated. I know that I'm in the zone of truth when stuff like that. And I'm talking about it and I'm getting goosebumps because it happens. So here, I'll back up a minute. After the doctor told me I was dying, and after the man I had married said he didn't love me anymore. I chased a miracle in California, and 16 weeks later, I got it. The cancer was gone, but when my brain caught up with it all, something broke. Do you believe now? They want some coffee. All right, I'll back up again. No, all right. Third time's a charm. All right. We have to hear this three times, because you know what? Peter had to hear it three times, didn't he? After the doctor told me I was dying, and after the man I had married said he didn't love me anymore, I chased a miracle in California, and 16 weeks later, I got it. The cancer was gone. But when my brain caught up with it all, something broke. I later found out that all the tragedy at once had caused a physical head trauma, and my brain was sending false signals of excruciating pain and panic. I spent 3 months propped against the wall. On nights that I could not sleep, I laid in the tub like an insect, staring at my reflection in the shower knob. I vomited until I was hollow. I rolled up underneath my bathrobe on the tile. The bathroom floor became my place to hide, where I could scream and be ugly, where I could sob and spit and eventually doze off, happy to be asleep, even if my head was on the toilet. I've had cancer 3 times now, and I'm barely past 30. There are times when I wonder what I must have done to deserve such a story. I fear sometimes that when I die and meet with God, he will say I disappointed him, or I offended him, or I failed him. Maybe he'll say I just never learned my lesson, or that I wasn't grateful enough. But one thing I know for sure is this. He can never say that he did not know me. I am God's downstairs neighbor. I bang on the ceiling with a broomstick. I show up at his door every day, sometimes with songs, sometimes with curses, sometimes with apologies, gifts, questions, or demands. Sometimes I use my key under the mat to let myself in. Other times I sulk outside until he opens the door to me. I have called him a cheat, I've called him a liar, and I've meant it. I have told him I've wanted to die. I meant that too. Tears have become the only prayer I know. Prayers roll over my nostrils and drip down my forearms. They fall to the ground as I reach for him. These are the prayers I repeat night and day, sunrise and sunset. Call me bitter if you want, that's fair. Count me among the angry, the cynical, the offended, the hardened. But count me also among the friends of God. For I have seen him in a rare form. I have felt his exhale laid in his shadow, squinted to read the message he wrote for me in the grout. I'm sad too. If an explanation would help, he would write me one. I know it. But maybe an explanation would only start an argument between us. I don't want to argue with God. I want to lay in a hammock with him and trace the veins in his arms. I remind myself that I'm praying to a God who let the Israelites stay lost for a decade. They begged to arrive in the promised land, but instead he let them wander, answering prayers they didn't pray. For 40 years, their shoes didn't wear out. Fire lit their path each night. Every morning he sent them mercy, bread from heaven. I looked hard for the answers to the prayers that I didn't pray. I looked for mercy bread that he promised to bake fresh for me every morning. The Israelites called it manna. Do you know what manna means? What is it? That's what manna means. That's the same question I ask again and again and again. There's mercy here somewhere, but what is it? What is it? What is it? I see mercy in the dusty sunlight that outlines the trees. I see mercy in my mother's crooked hands, in the blanket my friend left for me, in the harmony of wind chimes. It's not the mercy I asked for, but it is mercy nonetheless. And I learn a new prayer. Thank you. It's a prayer I don't yet mean, but I will repeat this prayer until I do. Call me cursed. Call me lost. Call me scorned. But that's not all. Call me chosen. Call me blessed. Call me sought after. Call me the one who God whispers his secrets to. I am the one whose belly is filled with loaves of mercy that have been hidden for me. Even on days when I am not so sick, sometimes I'll just go and lay on the mat in the bathroom floor and wait and listen for him. I know that sounds crazy, and I can't really explain it, but God is there even now. I have heard it said that some people can't see God because they won't look low enough. And I found it's true. If you can't see God, look lower. God is on the bathroom floor. Isn't that an incredible lesson in contentment? Incredible lesson in contentment. Yeah. And that's Nightbride is her name, if you want to go to her blog. She just got that golden buzzer in America's Got Talent, and she's a sweetheart. She is a sweetheart. Beautiful voice. If Simon gives you a golden buzzer, you've done something. So I'm going to end with that in prayer. Lord, contentment does not come easy to me. My heart is motivated by envy. My heart is motivated by my own success and my own popularity, my own fame, my own comfort, my own fortune. My heart is motivated by a lot of things that aren't glorifying to you and loving to my neighbor. But, Lord, you've promised by the Holy Spirit to give me a new heart, and that's the source of motivation. And so with the new heart, Lord, I follow the Holy Spirit. Lord, with the new heart, I surround myself with Christian community, consistent Christian community, to remind me of biblical values and to remind me of the love God has for me even when I make mistakes. Thank you for Nightbride and the work that you're doing in her life and that she's vulnerable. And Lord, that you've arranged it to give her a platform in which to share with the world her story, her story. We love you, God. We thank you so much for her story and that we can learn from it. Thank you from your word in Ecclesiastes to be content with little, be quiet, instead of blistering our fingers to try to keep up with the Joneses. Help us to be vulnerable and look at ourselves in your word and see where we can say we need to back off getting our kids that much stuff. They don't need it. We need to back off getting ourselves that much stuff. We don't need it. We need to back off working for the American dream. We don't need it. We need to be saved from ourselves and from the wrath of God. We love you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.